approximately 2 weeks later, after they were published in September of 2005, about 3,500 people demonstrated peacefully in Copenhagen. In November, a few European newspapers republished the images, triggered a few more protests. Labor strikes began in Pakistan the following month. Several organizations even criticized the Danish government. More protests happened in January. And later that month, a boycott of Danish goods was invoked. Few countries threw their ambassadors to Denmark out of the country. Widespread protests, some of them violent. They started to begin in January. Protests really picked up steam in February. In Damascus, Syria, both the Norwegian embassy and a building containing the Danish, Swedish, and Chilean embassies were stormed and set on fire by protesters. Those are the ones I told you was hired, sent out by the Illuminati to stir it up. In Beirut, thousands of people were protesting on the streets. And a lot of people in the Western world don't believe that those thousands were actually out there. They believe it was propaganda. Only do these people appear on the streets when television cameras show up. Well, of course, it's all orchestrated. At least one or two of the people that are on in the media in the Western world are catching on to at least that much. All the footage that you see from Iraq is all file footage. It's not the day of. Stuff they shot years ago, months ago. As of February 17th, 29 people were killed in the protests. 9 and 2 is, let me see, 11. Then, tonight, February 18th, 15 more, Nigeria, bringing the total to 44. Will the demonstrations, the protests, the violence, the deaths continue over the Danish cartoons? You bet if the Illuminati can help it. This is AM 640 Toronto Radio. I'm Space. There's more to come. Much more.
The Stafford Show. Though do not necessarily reflect those of AM 640 Toronto Radio. Deprogramming the brainwashed simply by uncovering the truth. He's the spaceman with a view from space. AM 640 Toronto Radio.
Welcome in. Show started about 9:45 tonight on AM 640 Toronto Radio. A view from space. If you just joined me, I want to welcome you if you're listening on AM 640 Toronto Radio on your car radio or logged on to AM640Toronto.com on your computer, getting the live audio streaming. Or if you're listening on Star Choice at channel 865 or Rogers Cable at 96.6. And soon, by the way, will be available on ExpressView. Tonight, the killer Danish cartoons. But just talking about the man responsible for running them. Not the editor. He's merely the cultural editor for that paper. Called the Jutland Post in English. Jyllandsposten in Danish. And when I was researching this, I found last November, September was when they were first published. Last November, about 2 months after they were published, Abu Laban, a Palestinian who used to work as a translator and assistant to top Gama Islamia leader Talal Fouad Qassemi during the mid-90s, and had been connected with Danish intelligence to other Islamists operating in Denmark, led a group that traveled to the Middle East to stir up rage using these cartoons with senior officials and the prominent Islamic scholars. They met with the Arab League secretary, Amr Musa, the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Sheikh Mohammed Sayed Tantawi, and also Sunni Islam's most influential scholar, Yusuf al-Qaradawi. He told them that they wanted to internationalize the issue so that the Danish government would realize that the cartoons were insulting not only to Muslims in Denmark, but also to Muslims worldwide. Abu Laban wanted to kind of trick these men into grabbing a hold of the cause and running with it, merely to make it an international event, a global story, instead of just a Danish one. Because Denmark is the hotbed of hotbeds for Islamic hatred at the moment, in the whole world. I'll get to that in a moment. This Danish Muslim delegation showed a lot more than the 12 cartoons published by the Jutland Post. In the Middle East, this delegation included other cartoons of Muhammad that were highly offensive, including one where the image had a pig face. But these additional pictures were not published by the newspaper, the Jutland Post, but were completely fabricated by the delegation and slipped into their booklet. So that they would really disturb the Arab League secretary, the Grand Imam, and Sunni Islam's most influential scholar. And they showed them. So do you believe it all happened innocuously, an accident? Or is it a deliberate attempt towards an ulterior motive? To answer that question, you need to go back in time, not too far, say of May last year, to a meeting of the high priests of globalization. Only 4 months before the crisis, between May 5th to May 8th, 2005, last year, a group of powerful men from today's finance, industrial, and political worlds huddled together in the warm and cozy rooms of that five-star Dorint Sofitel Sea Hotel Überfahrt in Rotach Egern in Upper Bavaria, a little village called Rotach Egern. Outside the hotel, private and state guards patrolled with automatic weapons and sniffer dogs and barbed wire fences. This secretive cabal of powerful men, otherwise known as the Bilderberger Group, meet occasionally. By the way, the Bilderberg Group is the only private international organization that Time magazine itself, a Time Warner Company asset, rated 10 for secrecy on a scale of 1 to 10. 10, of course, being the most secret. So what do the defamatory cartoons have to do with the Bilderbergs? And I know this has already been debunked in the mass media. Whenever you mention the Bilderberg meetings, people go, oh, here we go, conspiracy. Listen. And you just may see the connection. Let's first have a look at the names of some of the attendees of this May 2005 conference. We had Henry Kissinger, chairman of Kissinger Associates. Some incredibly famous names, even if you're not involved in the business world. Like Joseph Ackerman, chairman of the group executive committee for the Deutsche Bank. Philip Camus of EADS. That's the huge weapons maker in Europe. Home office, by the way, in Bavaria. Anders Eldrup, president of Dong. I'll fill you in on this fellow in a moment. He has a connection directly to the Jutland Post. As a matter of fact, as president of Dong, he oversees the Jutland Post because Dong owns the Jutland Post. There are so many others. William Ford, Jr., chairman and CEO of the Ford Company, he was there. Timothy Geithner, Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Ivo Giladi, strategic advisor to Prime Minister Sharon, who, by the way, I believe his funeral will be shortly after the Olympics. But then, that's just a guess. Donald Graham, son of Catherine, Washington Post CEO, where all the leaks come from in Washington. Spaceman, AM 640 Toronto Radio, just going through the list of guests at the Bilderberg meeting a few months before the cartoons were published last year at a quaint little Bavarian town. Richard Holbrook, vice chairman of Perseus. Did I mention Klaus Kleinfeld, president and CEO of Siemens? How about Hilmar Koper, chairman of the supervisory board, Daimler Chrysler? There's some incredibly huge names, so powerful. Here's one you might know. Irshad Manji. The girl that wrote that book on Islam that appears on a few shows here in Toronto, in Canada. Another Canadian that was there, Frank McKenna, who's now leader of the opposition. Angela Merkel. The first Lady Chancellor of Germany. And of course, these people are just getting together, what, in Bavaria too? Say hello. Have a coffee. And a Danish with each other. Deputy editor of Die Zeit, the German newspaper, Matthias Naas, was there. Her Majesty, the Queen of the Netherlands, was there. chairman of the board and CEO of Nokia Corporation. Jorma Olila was there. Oh, David Rockefeller was there. He goes to the mall, member of the J.P. Morgan International Council.